Good morning, everyone. Initially, I will start with the questions which are on crystallography. Then there are a few questions on quantum mechanics, which was on the earlier, on the Saturday session. So then I will talk about them thing, those things. But let us start with the questions on the crystallography portion. So the first question is from MGM College of Engineering, Nanded. This is a question which was not very clear to me, but I thought I made some sense out of the question. So let me just repeat. 3D Bravais lattice should have three directions and three primitive vectors, but in FCC Bravais lattice, primitive vectors I, vector j, vector k are missing while representing A, B, C respectively. In slide 12, I saw this particular thing. See, the thing is that it should have three directions and three primitive vectors. It does have three primitive vectors. See, what I had written there was A, B, C. So what I had written was that your the vector A is A by 2, J plus K. Then I have written B as A by 2, K plus I, and C as A by 2, I plus J. So these are indeed three vectors. It involves all the three directions, I, J, K. There is absolutely no ambiguity. My feeling is that this question has been asked that why I is missing here, why J is missing here, why K is missing here. Well, that is natural because, you know, eventually you have to look at three different directions. These three directions, could be mixture of these three directions, you know, any of these vectors. For example, if we take simple cubic, I write A is equal to AI. There is no J and K appearing here. Similarly, we write B is equal to AJ and C we write as AK. So it's not necessary that in every vector all the three directions should appear. It so happens that in BCC it does appear, but in simple cubic it does not appear, and in FCC it does not appear. So I do not see any contradiction as far as this question is concerned. Okay. In fact, you can always visualize this particular thing, because if you are going half the distance along the y directions and the z direction, it means you are looking at that particular point which is centering the y z plane. Okay. This is a particular point which is centering x and z plane. This is the point which is connecting the which is the center of x y plane. Okay. So I don't see any contradiction. I hope I have understood the question. The second question is from Kavi Kulguru Institute of Technology in Nagpur. The Miller index of a plane is never infinity but can be zero. Is there, can it be negative? Yeah, that's actually a good question, because I have unfortunately could not discuss that particular aspect of negative coefficient. You can always have a situation in which, you know, a particular plane intersects, okay, not just x, maybe intersecting, let's say, x direction and y direction or a direction and b direction in the positive side, but in the c direction, it has an intercept along the negative direction. So if it has a negative direction, the intercept in that particular direction will have a negative value. For example, you can have intercept which is, let's say minus a and a. So if this intercept is minus a, it means along the x direction or along, I mean, let's just take cubic to make it, life simple. Let's assume that this is simple. This is a simple cubic. In that case, you know, the intercept of this particular plane is along in the x direction is in the minus a, while along the y direction and the z direction it's along the plus a. Okay, so this is perfectly possible. You can always imagine a particular plane which is intersecting x direction in the negative a direction and not in the positive a direction. Then the intercepts will be minus 1, 1, 1. You take reciprocal, this becomes minus 1, 1, 1. When you write this particular mirror indices, you put actually not negative sign here, but on the top of. So you write bar 1, 1. So when you write a plane like this, or for that matter, in general, I write a plane H, K, L, or I write a plane H, let's say K, L. It means in this plane has intercept along the A direction in the negative direction. Here it has intercept, negative intercepts along B and C direction, and a positive intercept along A direction. So having a negative intercept is perfectly possible. And when we represent the Miller indices of these planes, I put a negative sign or a rather bar on top of that number, indicating that that particular intercept has happened in the negative direction. So there is no ambiguity as far as this particular aspect is concerned. Now this next question is from Walchand Institute of Technology, Solapur. Iron has BCC and has one atom basis, means it gives number of atoms per unit cell or anything else, but the BCC number of atoms per unit cell is 2. That's perfectly correct. See, remember, if it is a primitive unit cell will always have one particular point per cell. But when I am saying 2 points per unit cell, actually I am not using primitive unit cell, but I am using a conventional unit cell. And remember, I have always been mentioning that in the case of cubic lattices, normally we always take conventional cell as the simple cubic cell, unit cell. It means essentially it is in the form of a cube. When it is in the form of a cube, they are no longer primitive vectors. See, when I write A is equal to AI, B is equal to AJ and C is equal to AK, they are the primitive vectors of a simple cubic lattice. They are not the primitive vectors of BCC lattice. Okay. But on the other hand, because of my convenience, I want to talk of a cubic unit cell. Therefore, I am treating this particular lattice as sort of simple cubic lattice, and I am using the same unit cell which is cubical in the shape. In that case, if I do, I will get 2 points per unit cell. But then we should realize that this unit cell is not really a primitive unit cell, but is a conventional unit cell. Okay, so I hope I have answered this particular question. Then there is a next question about random stacking and polytypism. This is also again an interesting question. In fact, again, this I have avoided talking about it, but let's just understand it. See, when we were talking about close packing structures, we talked only of two type of structures, which are ABC. What it means that AB keeps on repeating every time. It's ABC which keeps on repeating every time. Like that. This we said is HCP. This we said FCC. Now, in principle, these are not the only possible type of structures. You could in fact have structures which, I mean, all that we want, that the two layers that we put one on the top of other should not have the same symbol. See, I will not have possibility of, let's say, ABC. When I put, let's say, ABC, after C I could put A or B. After C I cannot put C again, because then it's no longer close packing. So you can put, let's say, CB, okay, then you can put again C, then you can put again A, okay, you can put again, let's say, B. See, all that you want, that the subsequent two numbers cannot be identical. So if I put B on the top of B, then that does not form a close packing. All of them will be close packing structure. But if you look at this particular case, this appears that along the third direction, we have essentially a random stacking, because you have ABC, then you have BCA, then you know you can have a various type of random stacking. And then many times we say that this particular material is crystalline or regularly arranged in two dimension, but a sort of random in the third direction. So this is what we meant by random stacking, that you could always have random stacking in the third direction. Whether a really a crystal system exists like that or not, that's a different question. Okay, but theoretically speaking, it's always possible to have these type of behaviors. Now, what is polytypism? And in fact, in polytypism, you know, what happens, you know, some of such type of random, I mean, not I will call it random, periodic structures are found where periodicity is obtained after a very, very large number of such stacking. For example, you could have this type of thing, then it can repeat again exactly in the same fashion, ABC, BCA, B. Now, what you will call, because the repetition here is of this particular type of thing, so essentially in the C direction, your periodicity range has become much larger. Now, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So, there are 7 layers, after that the periodicity is maintained. Now, it appears that certain materials have been observed to have such type of stacking in which the repetition in the C direction, where this particular structure gets repeated, happens at a very, very large distance. Okay. Many times you have something like 100 layers and after that start stacking. Of course, there is always a question why a particular material, you know, sort of crystallizes in a particular structure, which has to do with the interatomic forces and minimization of energy. That's a different subject altogether. Now, in these type of things where you have a structure which is repeating after a long time is generally called polytypism. So there is always a question, why this polytypism, I mean, what are the type of forces which can give rise to polytypism? Now people feel that's not really, I mean, I'm not expert in this polytypism, I can give only from whatever my sort of general information is concerned. This polytypism is generally believed to be not because of really a forces, because normally these forces may not be that long range, okay. So it's generally we believe that there are certain type of defects or certain other type of things which actually give rise to this type of periodicity. So basically the moral of the story, whatever is I am saying, is that we have considered only two type of stacking when we are talking of close packing structures. One is AB, AB, AB type. Here repetition occurs after two cells AB, then repeats AB, AB, AB. Then we have a second type where repetition occurs after 3. So you have ABC, 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 ABC. But then in principle it's possible that you have various other type of stackings, at least theoretically possible. The only thing that you want, the two symbols may not be, should not be exactly same one after another, okay. So you can have, for example, ABC, BCA, AB, and for example this 7 layers could repeat after that, or it may not repeat at all. If it does not repeat at all, then we will call it random stacking. If they repeat after a very large number of iterations, we will call these things as a polytypism. So that is what I would like to say. Now there is another question. This is from Erode, Kongu Engineering College. Erode, it says clarify crystallites, grain and particles. This also I think I will spend some time, because I generally realize that many people are sort of confused, even our students are confused. See, normally an ideal structure is a crystalline structure, okay, but as we have said that many times you do not have a material, we do not use the material which is actually single crystal, because it is difficult or it is more expensive to make single crystalline materials in many cases, okay. If you do not care about making it perfectly crystalline material, you make what we call as a polycrystal. In that case, you know, these are comparatively simpler to make. So when we say a polycrystal, essentially it means that it consists of a large number of single crystal crystalline zone, which amongst themselves are oriented, maybe randomly, maybe in some preferential way. But it does not consist of a single crystal, it is a combination of a large number of single crystals. So let me draw let's say top view of a particular material, okay. The material could be, let's say, going deeper into inside it. Now if you look at the top, okay, for example here you could have a particular type of single crystal material, and let's suppose the x-axis of that, let's just take a cubic case to make it life or simple to understand it. So maybe this is x direction, this is y direction, this is z direction, y direction, and this will be z direction, like this, all right. Now you have another neighboring particular region which is also single crystal in its own way, but x axis is not in this particular fashion, but its x axis is, let's suppose, in this particular direction, and then y direction x like this, and z is like this, okay. The third one could have another type of orientation with respect to. So this could consist of a very large number of these single crystals. I mean, I am just giving some arbitrary structure, okay, in which all these individual particles are single crystals, but they are rotated, it could be randomly, it could be in a particular preferential fashion, arbitrarily with respect to the original, let us say, single crystallite. So now such type of materials we generally call as a polycrystalline material, because this particular material consists of very large number of single crystals. So that is why word poly, it is a polycrystalline material. And generally when you look at one of the single crystals within this polycrystalline, this we generally use the word grain. A grain means this is a single crystalline region within a polycrystalline material. These grain sizes, the size of this particular grain is very, very important. At least in this my area of recording, okay, one would like to control the grain size so that you obtain a particular type of magnetic properties. So these grain sizes are extremely important as far as application of this particular material is concerned. So this is what we mean by a grain. In a polycrystalline material, a small single crystalline region like a single crystal, okay, would be called a grain. And of course the grain sizes could be in general different. When we talk of the grain size, we have to talk about, let's say, the average grain size. We could talk about the distribution of the grain sizes. There are so many things that we talk about the grain sizes. When we say particles, particle essentially means that you are actually, for example, these days we talk of a lot of nanoparticles. Essentially, it means that your material is really very, very tiny. Here, the material is big. This is of, let's say, macroscopic dimension, but these grains could be exceedingly small. For example, they could be nanocrystalline, where the typical sizes are of the order of, let's say, 10 nanometers or 50 nanometers, or they could be much bigger grains, where they could be of the order of microns. Okay, but it depends again on the type of material that you are using. Okay, but when we are talking of particles, particles actually their shape, the size itself is a very, very small. So, if I take, let's say, a nanometer particle, it means, I mean, typically nanopowders, then typically the size of the particle itself would be of the order of 10 nanometers or 20 nanometers. Okay, so particle is really a very, very tiny thing. It's like a, you know, one of the particle of a powder, let's say, for example. Okay, of course, this particle size could be bigger. They may not be nano powders. Okay, it could be, let's say, micron size powders where you can have the typical, you know, particle size of the order of microns. Now, again, I mean, chances, if you are making a very fine powder, which is a nano powder, chances that there are grains within this powder may not be there. It may be there. So, whether these particles are polycrystalline or a single crystalline, that's a different issue. But basically, when we are saying powder, powder essentially means that they are really a tiny material, just like a normal talcum powder that you normally use at home. So, you see that it consists of a very, very fine particles. So, these are just the particles. Now, I just wanted to, I think somebody has asked this particular question about the orientation. See, what happens, or texture, what could happen that, as I said, that these grains here, in principle, could be randomly oriented with respect to each other, but many times it happens that these are not randomly oriented with respect to each other. For example, this particular material could be what we call as oriented material. It could happen in such a fashion that your C axis of all these grains is always normal to the film plane. I am talking of thin film, or you can talk of any other material, okay, that they could be all in this particular direction. If that happens, so their XY axis could be randomly with respect to each other, but C axis is same. Then we call that this is an oriented material or oriented film. Okay, it's also possible that there is a, some preferential alignment, but not a complete alignment. Okay, you know, if you look at the number of grains for which C axis is oriented like this, maybe much larger in comparison to grains for which C axis is oriented like this or like this or like this or like this. So we have some texture. It means the grains are not really random with respect to each other. Their, you know, orientation is not random with respect to each other. Okay, so what we call is that these materials are textured. Okay, now let's go to the next question. Next question is differentiate crystals and crystallites. I mean, when you say crystallite, generally we always mean small particles, or crystallite could also mean a grain. It depends on the reference to the context. The next question is from, I think, Shegaon, Sant Galan Engineering College. How the HKL values of polycrystalline sample material is to be found out? See, whenever we are talking of HKL value, we always assume the material is to be single crystal. Okay, when we are talking of polycrystalline material, okay, it essentially means that the grains are oriented with respect to each other. In fact, you still use the same Miller indices to define what is the orientation of one particular grain with respect to another. So, I mean, when we define Miller indices, it's always with respect to a single crystalline material. If it is polycrystalline material, individual planes of these particular grains will be different, like the example which I had given you just now. What is the physical meaning of Miller indices? Physical meaning I have tried to explain. This is basically to identify various planes. Next question is, for an FCC lattice, is there an easy method to find out the coordination number? Of course, I mean, coordination number can generally, I mean, I don't think there is a clear-cut, shortcut way of, you know, you just look at this one particular atom and find out how many nearest neighbors it could have. That's what is called coordination number. So, as you can see in the FCC material, if you take any particular point, you'll find 12 points which are nearest neighbor to it. So, in fact, in the case of FCC, let me just draw this particular picture. So, if you take this particular point, then you will find the nearest neighbors are the face centers, because this is at a distance of a by root 2, while this is a distance of a. So, this is the nearest neighbor. So, you will find that this particular point, there are 4 faces, 1, 2, 3, 4, okay, to which this is common. So, all these 4 faces will have center. So, there will be 4 nearest neighbor, 4 will be in this direction and 4 will be in this direction. So, it has 12 nearest neighbor. So, the coordination number is 12. So, this generally, you know, when I think only by visualization one can find it out. I am not sure whether there is any other method of this. The next question is from Raigarh. MES Pillay's Institute of Information Technology, for representing a plane direction, is it correct to take the reciprocal of the given indices rather than dividing by the highest integer? Yes, that's the standard way of taking the reciprocal. Okay, this is the way we do it. I mean, that's the convention we follow. So, I mean, we cannot say why we do this way. This is the way it's done. The next question is from JP Institute of Information Technology, Noida. In general, for cubic lattice, HKL is perpendicular to HKL plane. How to prove it? Of course, this is a little longer, longish proof. But, you know, it can, I mean, it's true that, you know, HKL direction is perpendicular to HKL planes, or rather normal to HKL planes, normal to HKL planes, only for cubic lattices. In fact, in general, if you take any arbitrary lattice, you will find its G vector, which is normal to the plane HKL. If you write G as HA plus KB plus LC, where HKL are integers, so this is a translation vector in the reciprocal lattice, then you will find that this turns out to be normal to HKL plane. So, this is the most general way of representing, looking at the angles between these things. Only for cubic lattices, it can be shown that HKL direction turns out to be normal. Okay, this, what you have to do, in fact, you know, I do not remember the exact derivation. You take this particular HKL plane, okay, then this particular intercept here is generally believed to be A by H. If this is A direction, this is B by K. And this is C by L. Then you write, this particular vector as A by H, B by K and C by L. Then find out what is this direction. This direction can be written in terms of this direction. Then you look at the direction HA, let us say HA plus KB plus LC. See, remember this is the direct vector, this was reciprocal lattice vector. Okay, then show that this is perpendicular to this. Then you take this particular direction, show again that this is perpendicular to this. Then take this particular direction, show again that this is perpendicular to this. So, you can show that this eventually turns out to be normal. So, there is a standard way of deriving it. Okay, if, I mean, this you can try it yourself. If you have any difficulty, you can probably contact me later. I will try to sort it out. The next question is that how to calculate grain and particle size from XRD. This is also a very interesting question, which again something which I have not talked about in the XRD, but because this may be of general interest, so I thought I will anyway mention about this particular thing. See, generally if you take a really infinite crystal and infinite solid, the X-ray beams, X-ray peaks that you will be getting should be sort of delta function. Okay, normally this is never a delta function. For example, by uncertainty principle, the wavelength that you are getting, there is always a small distribution. So, in principle, this particular line will have what we call as a natural line width, okay, because nu itself or lambda itself has a small amount of width because of uncertainty principle. So, you cannot, when you are talking a monochromatic beam, it cannot be 100% monochromatic. There is always going to be, you know, certain other wavelengths mixed up. So, therefore, there will be always what we call as a natural line width of this particular line, okay. But generally, when you are taking a finite sized material, okay, then you find that there is a further broadening, because there are many other reasons of broadening, but let me put it like that. If we assume that this particular line is further broadened, it becomes like this, okay, and this is mainly because of the finite, in fact, you can show that the finite size of a crystal will broaden this particular line. Then you look at the full width at the half maximum, it means you go half the way here and look at what is the width, okay. There is a well-known formula which is called Scherer formula. Okay, which relates this particular width to the average grain size or average particle size. Depending on which material that you are trying to take the X-ray, I mean whether you are taking let us say a thin film for example, or for example a powder, it can give you the average grain size or average particle size. Okay, this is a very, I mean this particular thing gives a sort of, I will say, approximately correct value only when the grain sizes are smaller than 100 nanometers. If it is more than 100 nanometers, then you know, this particular expression does not give you a very correct size, grain size. But this is sort of shortest and quickest method to measure grain sizes. In fact, that is the reason that a lot of students, including my own students, when they publish the paper, for the first estimate of the grain size, they actually always use the X-ray Scherer formula taking the width of these particular lines and taking from that particular thing what should be the approximate value of the average grain size. That's what they use. Okay, so this is very, very commonly used. Let me put it like that. If you have multiple materials, okay, the relative values, relative changes in the grain size can be fairly accurately predicted by Shearer formula. But if you want to take really the correct grain sizes, okay, it's not, one cannot be 100% sure, or one cannot be, even reasonably sure that these grain sizes are all right. And one of the other very, very important thing which sort of changes the grain sizes, increases the width of the X-ray line, is because of the stresses which are always present inside a material. So I say under quotes, you know, there is one way of finding, or this gives you one of the ways of finding out the grain sizes. In fact, as probably some of you are aware, the best way of finding out the grain sizes, most accurate way, is to do a dark field imaging in the transmission electron microscope. But you know, to make samples for transmission electron microscope is not very easy. Okay, and then you must have this particular facility. People also use AFM or SEM. To get an approximate idea of grain size and its distribution. See, remember, using these methods you can even get distribution, while the Shearer formula using X-rays will only give you the average grain size. There is no way that you can calculate the distribution of the grain sizes. But as I said, this being quickest, and anyway when the students are working for their PhD, okay, they will do XRD to find out whether they have made the material. XRD has to be done for every of their sample, and when they do the sample, they will anyway get this widths. From that, they can always get an idea of the grain sizes. So, as a very large number of publications which come these days probably use only Shearer formula to calculate the grain size, whatever might be the accuracy of it. And then there is one more question which is from Dehradun, University of Petroleum and Energy Studies, which is, what is the physical significance of the atomic radius since atom has no physical boundary? Is the distance between nucleus and valence electrons okay? It's again a very, very interesting question. It's true that physicists used to, long time back, used to avoid calling a atomic radius, okay, because atomic radius, though we have been using hard sphere model, but you know, we know that atoms are not really hard spheres. In fact, if they were really hard spheres, there would not have been any physical vibrations, there would not have any lattice vibrations, okay. But as we always say that we always try to approximate we try to take some idealized picture and then only we start talking about these things. Otherwise, you know, it's not, the physics is going to be too tough if we want to have all the realistic things. Okay, let me put it like that. When we say about approximately the atomic radius, which I have not used by the way, this particular word, atomic sphere, it does mean that I take this particular atom approximately as a sphere. Okay, and in fact, there are some books which always write, which is probably a correct word. They do not call it atomic radius. They will call as the shortest, let's not the shortest, half of the shortest distance of approach. So if you put two atoms together of the exactly identical way, what is the shortest distance between their nuclei that you can normally possess? Half of that we'll call as atomic radius. Now, as you see yourself say, which is correct, that the shape cannot really be put into spherical form properly if you go into, it's all rigorousness, okay. But this does give you an idea of how the packing, stacking takes place. That's all I would like to say. Now let's go to the other set of questions, which is for the yesterday's lecture. Okay, then first question is from Shegaon again. Is it okay for it's okay for single crystals, but how the polycrystalline sample is confirmed by XRD pattern? Again, a very interesting question. So I will just mention. See, unfortunately, all these things I just gave a bird's eye view on these things. I did not discuss the complete X-ray diffraction and other things in its in more detail. That would have taken probably another 2-3 lectures if I have to do it a proper thorough job. But let me just tell you that in the case of the standard XRD machines that we are using these days, okay, the material has to be polycrystalline in order that you see all the possible peaks. So, because if you remember what we have discussed, that the condition of Bragg reflection, which is specular reflection as well as 2d sin theta is equal to l lambda, is satisfied for only these grains, only for these particular planes. Essentially, you have a situation when you have theta corresponding to this and this, and this theta is continuously being varied. Okay, you are varying this theta as well as you are varying this particular theta. So, you are looking only at the top of the plane. You are not looking at any of these planes. For example, if I have given you an example, there can be multiple ways of drawing the planes, but the way the modern XRD machine works, mean, at least in theta to theta geometry. Of course, there are other geometries also when this is not correct. So, in theta to theta geometry, which is the most standard geometry which we use in XRD, okay, essentially you are scanning on the top, only the top of the planes. Okay. Now, if this material is actually a single crystalline, then this particular plane is, let's suppose, is let's say 100. So, this, if these planes are 100 and if this material is single crystalline material, okay, then D of this will correspond to 100 direction. So, you can get only diffraction from 100 planes, you will not get diffraction from any other plane, because 111 plane does not exist here, okay, or 200, I mean, let us say 311 plane, for example, does not exist there, all right. So, if you are using a single crystalline material, then you will, in this particular thing, and if this is oriented along 100 direction, you will get only 100 peak, or you will also get 200 peaks or 300 peaks, provided it is allowed by the space group. You know, that is what I have said, that not all reflection is allowed for every type of lattice. Okay, let us assume this is simple cubic. In fact, there is no material which actually crystallizes into simple cubic with a single atom basis. Okay, but just for the sake of argument, let us take a simple cubic material. Then you will have 100, 200, 300, because this is second order reflection from 100, this is third order reflection from 100. Okay, only these reflections will be present, all others will be absent, because those planes do not exist here. Okay, now only when I am using a polycrystalline material, then what will happen, that for some particular material, the top will contain, this will be 100, for some other grain it may be 111, for some other grain it may be let us say 311, and if I have the very fine mesh of the grain sizes, okay, in principle there is an equal probability of finding every type of orientation on the top plane. Then only you will start getting all other peaks like 110, 111, you know, 211, 311, then you start getting all the peaks. So, in fact, this particular material, this particular thing is most suited only for polycrystalline material and not really for single crystalline material. Because, of course, you can do single crystalline material, but then you will get the peaks only corresponding to what is the plane on the top. Okay, the second question was from Buldana, which, okay, it is actually the same college, same question. We use Bragg's law derived from reflection of X-rays from atoms, but the technique used Bragg spectrometer is called X-ray diffraction. In fact, as I have told you, that the technique is only X-ray diffraction. It so happens that because in X-ray diffraction condition, the condition of a specular diffraction is satisfied. So, many times we call it reflection. We should, strictly speaking, should not use the word reflection. We should call only X-ray diffraction. Okay, but as I say, people, you know, while loose talking or what we call as a misnomer, people call it X-ray reflection. Okay, it's not reflection. In fact, I have told you, had it been a reflection, when there is X-ray beam which is coming, you'll always get a reflected beam. Okay, there cannot be any further condition imposed. A normal reflection, for example, a light reflection, is that whenever you are putting, you know, your light, you always get a reflected light. Okay, you do not have any further condition satisfied. But while here, you have to have not only angle of incidence equal to angle of reflection, but you must also have 2d sin theta is equal to lambda. So, it is not necessary that you will always get a reflected beam. So, it is actually not reflection, it is diffraction, but somehow, I mean people many times use words which are sort of loose words. So, people call it X-ray reflection. How do we measure a plane for a particular peak? You know, this actually has been done by fitting. That is not a very always simple. For cubic lattices, it is comparatively simple, because you can look by the ratios of sin square theta values and get the idea of what are the type of planes. In fact, this exercise we normally give to our students in our MSc class to work it out. Okay, but if you are taking it really in arbitrary lattice, these are not really very easy things. And you know, these days, of course, there are support from the softwares where you can give all these data and then they can tell you which is likely to be the structure of the particular material. The next question is that in case of X-ray diffraction, when X-ray as an electromagnetic wave is entering inside the crystal, then why we are not taking under the consideration the refractive index of the material? See, thing is that, you know, when we are talking of the refractive index of the material, when we are treating that material as a continuum material, okay, here the wavelengths are of the order of interatomic spacing. See, for example, when we are using light, okay, light has a typical wavelength of 4000, 5000 angstrom. Okay, while, you know, the interatomic spacing is of the order of 1 angstrom. So, when this particular light is actually being incident on a, let us say, a glass slab, okay, we do not consider this glass slab to be made of atoms, okay, which are placed at 1 angstrom distance apart, because the wavelength is too large. So, this particular material can be treated as a continuum material. First of all, when you take a vibration of a string, okay, in vibration of strings, of course, this string is consisting of atoms. Okay, I never consider the vibration of the atoms in this particular case, because my wavelength that I am going to excite is much, much longer than this particular atomic spacing. So, for all practical purposes, I can treat this particular material as a continuum material, as if it is perfectly continuous material. Then we talk in terms of tensions and other things which we are talking about, of the macroscopic property. Similarly, when you are talking of refractive index, we are talking about its macroscopic property, treating this glass slab as a continuum medium. But on the other hand, when I am talking of X-ray diffraction, X-rays have typically, in fact, in case we are seeing X-ray diffraction, their wavelength has to be of the order of interatomic spacing. So, the typical X-ray wavelength that we are using are also of the order of 1 angstrom. So, then you cannot treat this particular material as a continuum material. So, these properties like refractive indexes, etc., have no meaning, which are defined for a continuum medium. I have to treat this particular material as a set of individual atoms, okay, then only I can talk about it, and that is what we have done. NaCl has interpreting two FCC lattice. Can we consider this NaCl lattice as a new lattice in reality apart from the 14 Bravais lattices? Of course, you can always call it a lattice, but not a Bravais lattice. Okay, that is what I have been talking. I have given you an example of many structures which are periodic structures, okay, which will not be a Bravais lattice if we just replace all these particular points by their own points. For example, diamond structure. Okay, if you replace all these carbon atoms by one particular point, okay, this will not form a Bravais lattice. But on the other hand, okay, if you want to insist in terms of Bravais lattice, and why we insist on Bravais lattice, because it is only a Bravais lattice which has that translational symmetry. And this translational symmetry is very, very important when we are talking of, let us say, band structure calculation, okay, when we are talking of, let us say, band properties or any other important properties. And it is very, very important to talk about these. The fact that there is a translational symmetry, it means the environment of every particular particle, every particular point is exactly identical. Okay, this will not happen if I am going and I treat this particular thing as a non-Bravais lattice, because non-Bravais lattice means you do not have this periodic symmetry, periodic translation symmetry. Okay, so you could call it, but you know that will not be a Bravais lattice. Okay, as I have discussed last time, Bravais lattice can only be 14. Why it is necessary to conceive the idea of a reciprocal lattice? Okay, this is always a question of why we want to do it. Okay, a lot of students do ask this type of questions, and I start always arguing in an opposite fashion, which is probably not a good way of doing, but nevertheless I do to convince people. For example, why I say 2 multiplied by 2 is equal to 4, why we will not say 2 multiplied by 2 is 5, okay, it's the way, because that is the way we have defined it. Why we have defined it that way, not 2 multiplied by 2 is equal to 5, why we have defined 2 multiplied by 2 is equal to 4, okay, it is because we are likely to face certain type of problems later, okay, in which it will be easy if I remember 2 multiplied by 2 is equal to 4. Okay, that was probably the simplest example, but I remember as a high school student, where first time the vector products were introduced to us, dot product and cross product, okay, we were sort of amazed. When we talk of multiplication of two things, there can be only one type of multiplication. 2 multiplied by 2 can only result 4, it cannot result 2 multiplied by 2, we cannot get into 5. But when you are defining vectors like say dot products, sometimes you can get AB cos theta, sometimes you get AB sin theta. Okay, sometimes it has a direction, sometimes it does not have a direction. So, why do we define that way? Okay, then you later realize that there is certain amount of easiness when we go to the later part of physics, if I define the direction. Okay, for example, if I say the force is V cross B, okay, I have to just write V cross B. So long you understand the cross product, you understand what will be the direction, what will be the magnitude of the force. All right, I remember in some of the earlier textbooks, you know, which were there, I mean, when I was essentially a child, study. You have so many right-handed rule, left-handed rule. You have to remember if this is the direction of velocity, this is the direction. I don't remember those rules now anymore. Okay, okay. Then this is the direction of the force. So you have to, for every law, you have to remember what will be the direction of the thing. Now you have once defined using cross product V cross B, things become much easier. So all you have to remember is what is the definition of cross product. Once you remember that definition, it makes easiness in understanding the later part of the physics. We just say force is V cross B. All right. So, that is R. When we say torque is R cross F, or when we say angular momentum is R cross P. Okay. So, then direction, magnitude, everything is inherent. I have to only explain you what is the cross product once, then all those things can be expressed in terms of R cross P. So, that is the way, that is the reason we define reciprocal lattice. Once we define reciprocal lattice, okay, you find it strange, but then you do solid state physics, you realize that things become so simple if I introduce the concept of reciprocal lattice. If I would not have introduced reciprocal lattice, to write those conservation of crystal momentum would have been much, much more difficult. I do not know how I will explain to you. The next question is, how are the planes, for example, 100, 110, 011 identified in a grown crystal? Okay, in a grown crystal to identify is, classic traditionally people have been doing by looking at, you know, how can you cleave and things like that. Okay, I mean, the only way I can think about it is that if you do not do that, you know, you do an X-ray diffraction. I mean, I have told you how to find out, you know, using X-ray diffraction. At least I have given you some idea, okay, how one can get some idea of orientation of the crystals in which particular plane. And of course, if it is a cubic direction, 100 and 010 and 001, will all the three be identical? There is no way that you can distinguish between them. For a particular glancing angle, why we do not get same plane diffraction as shown in your table, for example, 100 and 200. That's what I told you. 100 and 200, 100 is n is equal to 1 order diffraction from 100 plane, 200 is n is equal to 2 diffraction from 100 plane. It does happen that it may be possible that 100 plane may not be present, but 200 plane may be present, because it again depends on the condition of constructive interference. When you are talking of 2 times lambda, the path difference may lead you to lambda. With 1 lambda, this may give you destructive interference. With 2 lambda, it may give you constructive interference. So that is possible. There is nothing very surprising about it. Why we take the powder XRD thin films and single crystal XRD for crystal? I mean, whatever is your material that you are making, you are going to take XRD only of that particular material. Can we use Brillouin zones for real time application of crystal, or it's simply theoretical way? I mean, again, I say that I will answer the same way. Brillouin zone is a very, very important concept of solid state physics. Okay, you will not be able to understand what are the realistic values of wave vectors which are allowed when you have a complete translational symmetry. And only those k values which are lying in the Brillouin zone are of importance. I mean, I do not think we can understand solid state physics concept without introducing Brillouin zone. So, I mean, though this looks somewhat theoretical, but I mean that way 2 multiplied by 2 is equal to 4 is also a theory. Okay, but you know, on the other hand, you know, we can see what is its usefulness. Similarly, once you go a little bit advanced in condensed matter physics, you realize that the concept of Brillouin zone is very, very interesting. Because I have told you that, for example, if you are taking the wave vectors, let us say of electron in a band structure, okay, the wave vectors which are allowed for this particular electron to be present are only those which are in the first Brillouin zone. Because the second Brillouin zone, whatever are the larger values of k, they can always be represented by an equivalent value of k in the first Brillouin zone. So maybe I am not sure whether you have understood this particular fact, but only thing I would suggest that, you know, you can take it that, you know, the concept of Brillouin zone is a very, very important and interesting concept. So I think I have exhausted all the questions that I have received so far on the crystallography. What are remaining questions are the questions of quantum mechanics, because there has already been some delay. So I thought I will start with my lecture, because I'm left only with about half an hour. So let me start with my lecture on relativity. Let me at least introduce special theory of relativity. I think one theory of physics which almost everyone knows, I mean, even if the person is not a physicist, is the special theory of relativity. And that is because of most brilliant work by Einstein. And people definitely know about E is equal to mc square if they don't know anything else. But this relationship has become so, what we call as a folklore, almost everyone knows E is equal to mc square. And everyone associates it to the brilliance of Einstein. Okay, so this particular theory is I always enjoy this particular thing teaching to first year students. Okay, and what is interesting, that's more than 100 years that this particular theory was brought out, and even today when I teach this to the first year students in IIT, they have a shock. They say, no, this is not possible. I mean, this is such a brilliant theory, it's such a brilliant piece of work. Okay, and as probably all of you know, that Einstein got Nobel Prize much later after the discovery of special theory of relativity, but you know that Nobel Prize did not cite its work on special theory of relativity. It only cited the explanation of photoelectric effect. Okay, special theory of relativity was not sort of accepted by the people. It's only at much later time when people have started having a lot of experiments, and then they found that many of the explanations, many of the predictions which special theory of relativity gave, really turned out to be correct. So today we believe in special theory of relativity, but you know, you realize that some of the postulates which are there are fairly shocking. Okay, so let's start with the special theory of relativity. I will not be able, because we have only 4 lectures, and out of which also I have spent some time here. I'll also be spending some time in answering questions. So I don't think I'll be able to do a small, even the mildest justice to special theory of relativity. Okay, but you know, let's just go sort of at least introduce, give you a feeling, or what normally people call, give you a flavor of special theory of relativity, just to get you an idea of what is this all about. Okay, so. Now let's go to the So what is my plan in special theory of relativity? That I will identify first the issue with classical physics, why special theory of relativity was needed, and how this particular theory helped in overcoming those issues. Then give a flavor of some of the new definitions. I am only talking about the flavor, okay? Not talking too much of how do we obtain, okay? Partly because of lack of time, partly because they cannot strictly speaking derive. Like we cannot derive Schrodinger equation, we will not be able to derive these things. We give only a series of arguments, but again, even those arguments I will not be able to give in this limited time. And as I said, I will focus more on concepts and not so much on mathematics. Okay, so just to, as I said, I'm becoming purely defensive. Give just a flavor of the special theory of relativity. Now, when I started this series of lectures, you know, I have talked about the two dark areas, or what we call many times clouds, on the classical physics, which was in the late 19th century. About the cloud one, I had talked in detail about the failure of Maxwell-Boltzmann doctrine regarding the equipartition of energy, and specifically talked about the blackbody radiation and how it led to quantization of energy and how it led to eventually the quantum mechanics. Now, at that time, we had mentioned about the second cloud, about which I did not talk, and I said I will talk about it when we discuss special theory of relativity. So this is the cloud about the motion of Earth in ether. So let us first understand this particular cloud in detail before we actually start special theory of relativity. Before we start, let us first introduce the concept of a frame of reference. Probably all of you are aware, but I mean, I know in first year students in IIT, everyone knows very well concept of frame of reference, inertial, non-inertial frame of reference, but nevertheless, I like to introduce it again. Just because, in fact, I said as my experience in teacher, as a teacher, I always like to launch a course from a particular point where the students are fairly comfortable, okay, so that they feel that they know the subject well, then only go to more and more difficult topic. In fact, I have found this strategy to be helping very well, because if there is a gap between what they know and what I am going to teach, probably they are never going to appreciate what what I am going to talk about it. So I introduce a concept which I know that at least the students in the first year level in IIT are very well familiar with, which is the concept of an inertial frame of reference. Okay, let's first say what is a frame of reference. Frame of reference is basically to tell where my observer is located. Okay, observer could be located on Earth, observer could be located on, let's say, Sun, okay, if at all it's possible, or on Moon, okay, or it could be in a moving car or a moving train or at center of some galaxy or whatever it is. All right, so there is one particular observer which is sitting somewhere, and there where that particular observer is able to draw his or her x, y, and z axis, and has methods of measurement of distances and times, etc. So that particular observer can calculate what is the speed of a particle, can find out what is the location of the particle, can calculate what is the acceleration of the particle, can know what is the force on a particle, all the dynamical things one can know in that particular sitting at a particular place. Okay. So, whatever is that particular place, you know, for example, if it is Earth, then Earth becomes my frame of reference. If the observer is sitting on train, that by train is my frame of reference. In fact, in normal classical mechanics, especially the mechanics that we do at the in high school level, one of the very common mistakes people make is to confuse the frames of reference. I always say that choose a particular frame of reference and then only you can apply mechanics properly. So, it is very, very important to realize where my observer is sitting when I am saying velocity, which is the observer which is measuring this velocity. Okay, so now generally frame of references are considered of two type. One is what is inertial frame of reference, another is what is called a non-inertial frame of reference. And inertial frame of reference is defined is that a isolated object moves with constant velocity. So essentially it means that if we take one particular object very far away from all other objects, then that particular particle is expected to move with a constant velocity. In classical mechanics, in macroscopic world, okay, generally the forces are always occur as a pair. I mean, this is Newton's third law of motion, that they always occur in pair. So if there is a force on this particular body, okay, it must be, if it is a real force, it must be experienced by there must be some another body which must apply this particular force on this particular body. So, if there are two bodies which must interact, then only this particular force from this body can be applied on this particular body. And when a force is seen on this particular body, the body which is applying the force, that will experience an equal and opposite force. That is what is Newton's third law of motion. Remember, the force and its reaction are on two different bodies. So, if this body is applying a force on this body, then this body will also apply a force on this particular body, and these forces are equal and opposite. So, all the forces occur in pair. Okay. So, there cannot be an isolated force on this body without looking at any body, other body nearby, which can apply a force on this particular body. And also, for most of the common forces that we come across, we know that if I increase the distance between these forces, generally the forces go down, take gravitational force, take electrostatic forces. Remember, I am talking macroscopic words, okay, not really talking about the particle, in the nuclei, etc. Of course. So, if I am able to remove the distance, if I take this particular distance of these two bodies very far from each other, then the force between these two bodies with respect to each other is definitely going to go down. So, if I am taking one particular object and move it to infinity or to a very large distance where it does not see any particle nearby, any particular object nearby, then there cannot be a real force on that particular particle. And if my observer finds that particular object to be moving with a constant velocity, then I will call that this observer is sitting in an inertial frame of reference. Now, the word spatial in spatial theory of relativity means that we are dealing only with inertial frames. So, many times discussing these things, I may not always call inertial, but you should realize that when we are talking of spatial theory of relativity, we are talking only of inertial frame of reference. If because of some reason I have to use the word non-inertial, I will specify at that time that is a non-inertial frame of reference. Otherwise, we take this just as an inertial frame of reference whenever I am talking of frame of reference. So, as I said, unless specifically mentioned, we shall assume that the observations are being made only in an inertial frame of reference. So, that is why this is spatial theory of relativity. It talks only of inertial frames. Now, we talk about Newtonian mechanics. I am making two statements. Let us see whether all of you agree with that. Then I will show that this is actually correct. First statement which I make, that velocity is a frame dependent quantity. If I go to a different frame, I may find the velocity of the same particle to be different, which is very normal, very natural. If I am standing on earth, I may find a particular tree to be stationary. But if I observe the same tree sitting in a train, I will find that this tree moves backwards. Okay. So, this velocity is actually a frame dependent quantity. So, from where you are observing this particular particle, okay, that actually determines its velocity. But what is important to realize that even though velocity is frame dependent quantity, acceleration will not be same. Acceleration does not depend on the frame. So, whether I am sitting on the earth, assuming earth to be an inertial frame, which is strictly speaking it is not, but assuming that earth is an approximately inertial frame of reference and there is a train which is moving with constant velocity, which is also an inertial frame of reference, okay. In that particular case, the two particular particles, if their body is accelerating, okay, you will find that the acceleration turns out to be same. Both of them will calculate the same value of acceleration. Let us just show this by a particular diagram and convince yourself that the statement that I am making is true. So, let us suppose we have two frames of reference. Normally, frames of reference are always represented by a set of axes. So, when I have a frame, I call it S frame. Okay, this S frame, I am denoting by red axis. So, this is my X direction, okay, and this is my Y direction, and this is my Z direction. And I have another frame, S prime, where the axes I have written by blue color. I am not sure whether you are able to see the color very clearly in your centers. So, this is your X prime, this is your Y prime, and this is your Z prime. And because of some convenience, I am choosing a particular set of axes. One can show that this is not, will not lose any generality. I am assuming that X and X prime axes are always constant with respect to each other. Y and Y prime axes are parallel, and Z prime axes are also parallel. See, physics are not going to be dependent on what we take as X, Y and Z axes. Okay, we choose appropriately X, Y, Z axes so that my mathematics becomes simple. Now, let us suppose that there is an object here. Of course, let us assume that S prime with respect to S moves with respect to velocity. Okay, and because S and S prime both are inertial frame of reference, therefore, if they have to be inertial frame of reference, let us say S has to be, is the inertial frame of reference, S prime can be inertial frame of reference only if their relative velocity is constant as a function of time. Okay, it means the velocity of S prime, which I am again assuming it is all in this particular direction, but this derivation will not depend on that particular thing. You can see that derivation will not take, will be same in spite of the fact that, you know, we may choose a different set of axes. Yeah. All right. So, what we are trying to do is that we are looking at one particular point. Both observers S and S prime are looking at this particular object. S prime, let's assume, is moving relative to S with a velocity, constant velocity v. Okay. Now, the position vector of this particular point with respect to these x, y, z axis is this, which I am writing as rt. So, there is no prime here because I am talking a frame of reference which is S, which is also not primed. So, this is rt. It means this r, of course, would be a function of time, because in general this observer may find this particular point to be moving in any arbitrary direction. Okay. So, this r position vector will be a function of time. At different time this r may be different. Now, same point at the same time was being observed by another frame of reference, which I am calling as S prime frame of reference. Okay. And that particular person finds out its position vector to be r prime t. Okay. So, here I am using prime, indicating that this is being observed by an observer S prime. All right. So, as you can see very clearly through the identity, that this rt is sum of these two vectors. This vector is a capital rt, which gives the relative position of O prime or position of O prime with respect to O. So, this is the vector which gives you the position of the origin of S prime frame of reference with respect to S. Okay. So, you can very easily see that this rt is r plus this r prime t. So, if I have to go from here to here, okay, this is the same as going from here and then going here. So, this rt is sum of these two vectors, capital rt plus r prime t. Okay. Now, let us differentiate these two vectors with respect to time, these two sides with respect to time. Okay, this was my equation. If I differentiate this with respect to time, I will get velocity of this particular object. Dr dt is the object velocity. Dr prime dt will give me the velocity of the particle as will be measured by an observer sitting in S prime frame of reference. And if I differentiate r with respect to t, I will get v naught, where v naught will be the velocity of S prime frame with respect to S frame. All right. So, now you can see that velocity as will be measured by S frame will be different from the velocity which is being measured by S prime frame of reference, and the equation is that vt is equal to v naught plus v prime t. All right. Now, I differentiate once more with respect to time. If I differentiate velocity with respect to time, I will get acceleration. Okay. When I differentiate on the right hand side, because this v naught has to be constant, because we are talking only of inertial frames. Okay. So, this will be 0 time derivative. So, this will be equal to dv prime dt, which is the acceleration of the same object or same particle being observed by S prime frame of reference. So, we can see that the acceleration of that particular particle measured by S and S prime will turn out to be identical. So, this is what is the statement that I had made earlier, that in Newtonian mechanics, you will find that velocity is a frame dependent quantity. This velocity is a frame dependent quantity. The two objects, two frames of reference do not agree with the value of velocity that they have obtained. According to one, the velocity is something, another according to another, you have to add this velocity v naught, then only you will get that particular velocity of the object. But on the other hand, both the observers will agree that the acceleration is same. Now, I make another statement about Newton's law of motion. Okay. I mean, as I said earlier, Newton's law, normally we mean Newton's second law. Okay. This is the Newton's law of motion, F is equal to ma. We just now see, if we go from one inertial frame of reference to another inertial frame of reference, acceleration would be identical. Okay. Now, if we assume, because this is a very important if we assume that the forces seen on the particle is same in both the frame of reference, which generally we thought of that way in Newtonian mechanics, then this F is equal to ma can be equally well applied in all the inertial frames. So, if the forces are same in all the frame of reference, F is equal to ma can be equally well applied into all inertial frame of reference. Okay. So, all inertial frames appear to be equivalent. However, probably once I have made this statement and I have emphasized on this aspect, provided force is same in all the frame of reference, probably this would have clicked to you that there are forces which also are velocity dependent forces. I mean, I have been giving example just now in the morning. Okay, by taking the example of a cross product, there is a Lorentz force V cross B. Okay, it depends on the velocity of the charge. So, if there is a particular charge which is moving with the velocity V, then V cross B will be the force on that particular object, and we have just now said that V is actually a frame dependent quantity. does it mean that this force is also a frame dependent quantity? Okay, so you will realize that so long we have not been talking about electromagnetic theory, if you talk of purely mechanical motions, okay, you will find that probably Newton's law of motion can be equally well applied in all inertial frame of reference. We start landing into problem when we try to mix up the electromagnetic theory with respect to the Newtonian mechanics. And that's what I am going to emphasize, and that's what I am going to call as the second cloud or second black spot, okay, on the classical mechanics. Let us understand this particular thing. Okay, of course, I say from Newton's law, velocity can be evaluated in any frame. We must specify the initial condition in a frame to know the velocity. See, equation is same, F is equal to ma. Okay, if you go from one frame to another frame, the frame S will put its own initial condition and can find out what is the velocity at a given time of the particle. Frame S prime observer will put its own initial condition, solve these equations, and then calculate what will be the velocity at time t is equal to 0 and find out what is the velocity at time at particular time t, knowing the force, etc. So all those things can be done. The problem is that you have a velocity dependent force, which is QE plus V cross V. We had just now said that this particular V depends on different frames. If it depends on different frames, does it mean that this force also depends on different force frames? Of course, you can always say that this magnetic field is also represented by a motion of charge carriers, okay, and B will be frame dependent quantity. Okay, in fact, strictly speaking, that's correct. In fact, Professor Ghosh asked me to specifically mention about this particular point, that in principle, what is pure electric field or what is pure magnetic field in relativity, okay, can be a mixture of the two. Unfortunately, we will not be able to do in this particular series of lectures the transformation of electric field and magnetic field, because that requires a lot more working. Okay, but I'm sure you can look into the books and look about the transformation of these forces. Okay, but let's not go into those details at this particular moment. But let's just understand the problem. So, we have first problem is that if V is frame dependent quantity, does it mean that this magnetic force will also be frame dependent? Alright. Then if it is so, then F is equal to ma cannot be equally applied in all the inertial frames. Okay. So we have some issue, but let's list the second issue, which appears to be much more interesting and much more thought provoking in that sense. See, I think Professor Ghosh has done electromagnetic theory, and he must have derived this particular condition that C, the speed of light, turns out to be equal to 1 upon under root epsilon naught mu naught. You realize that epsilon naught mu naught are fundamental constants. This epsilon naught determines the force between two charges. Mu naught determines the forces between two current carrying wires. Alright, both of them are believed to be fundamental constants. So therefore, C is supposed to be a fundamental constant. Okay, let us look how does this second problem manifest itself when we are talking about different frames. So let us first look at this particular problem, which I am sure all of us have noticed it. Let us suppose there is an observer on ground. Okay, let us assume that this ground is an inertial frame of reference, though you know that ground is not, strictly speaking, not inertial frame of reference. But for many of our discussion, let us start assuming that this is an inertial frame of reference. Okay, so this particular person notices one particular train or particular car going to the right hand side with the direction V. Let us assume that these are all unidirectional motion and V is along the x-axis. And he also notices that there is another car which is moving to the left hand side with a speed U, which is an opposite direction. Alright, now my question is that if there would have been any other observer sitting in A, this particular frame of reference or this particular car or this particular train, what is the speed of this particular object or train B which he or she would have observed? As all of you know, that this would have been V plus U. Okay, if you are sitting on a train and a train passes against you and from opposite direction, it appears to be moving very fast. Okay, this is because the relative velocity is V plus U. On the other hand, if the situation was somewhat different, in the sense that this train was also moving in this direction, the other train was also moving in the same direction, then what will be the velocity of this particular train as seen by this? Okay, this will be U minus V. All right. So this is also very clear that if you are driving on road and there is a car which is going by its side, okay, you find that the velocity of that particular car with respect to you is comparatively much smaller. If the car was coming opposite to you, you will find the speed to be much larger. This is very, very natural things that we always see in our daily life in mechanics. Now let's do the same experiment with light. Everything same, other than that this carriage which was there, this carriage I have replaced by a light source. So this, there is a light source. Of course, light source is not moving. Okay, it's only throwing light. So light is moving. So you have a source, okay, the light is coming, and let's assume that this particular speed of light is c as being measured by this observer. So it's exactly same condition. So this observer find a carriage or car moving to the right hand side with the speed u. He also finds that light is coming towards this particular car, and as measured by this particular observer, this particular light is c. The speed of this particular light is c. Then putting the same arguments, if an observer was sitting here, he would notice that speed of light will be u plus c. Now if you have a different situation, that the car is moving this particular way and a light is, somebody shines a light from this particular side, then a person sitting here, remember this c and u both are being measured by this observer sitting on the ground, then an observer sitting here would notice that the speed of light will be c minus u. So just like the case here, where this observer notices two different velocities of this train b, here also if we apply the same classical mechanics idea, this observer would notice, this particular observer will notice different speeds of light in this situation and in this situation. Okay, it means, as I said, this should also apply to light. If it applies to light, then speed of light should also turn out to be frame dependent quantity. But that is where we have a problem. We have just now said that c depends on fundamental constants. Okay, now if c is frame dependent quantity, does it mean to say that these fundamental constants are also frame dependent? Okay, does it mean that they are no longer fundamental? That's where the issue. Is speed of light frame dependent? If yes, is the following expression is also valid in all the frame of reference? If it is so, then epsilon naught and mu naught also are becoming frame dependent, implying fundamental constants epsilon naught and mu naught are also frame dependent. And if epsilon naught and mu naught are frame dependent quantities, then electric forces and magnetic forces will also become frame dependent quantity, because you know electric forces, charge between two forces, okay, if you take the Coulomb's law, 1 upon 4 epsilon naught q prime upon r square, okay, if epsilon naught has changed, okay, force between two charges will change. Okay, if I go to a different frame in which epsilon naught is different, force between these same two charges will be different. Similarly, if mu naught has become different in a different frame, then forces between two current carrying current will become different in different frames. Okay, so this looks little surprising that in mechanics we had always the situation where we appeared the forces are to be, if you are talking about, let's say, friction force, or if you push a body, okay, you always feel that the force is same irrespective of whether you are observing here or a person sitting in the train is observing. But here it appears that if I change my frame of reference, the electric force and magnetic forces will become frame dependent quantity. It's not a situation which about which you are really happy. Of course, there is another possibility that whatever I am trying to say is not really correct, though of course, light could be frame dependent, okay, possible that light is frame dependent, but somehow I do not want to have epsilon naught mu naught to be frame dependent. Okay, so let's assume another situation that this expression c is equal to 1 upon under root epsilon naught mu naught is not frame dependent, okay. It's specifically valid only in one spatial frame. So this is what I am mentioning it. Or is it that the following expression is valid only in some specific frame? So let's assume that this frame is this particular equation that I have derived on the basis of electromagnetic theory is not a universal equation. Okay, this equation is valid only in certain spatial inertial frames. Okay, are these two type? Are there two types of inertial frame? Okay, see, at the moment we have said, I mean, in Newton's law of mechanics, if you remember, we have always been telling all inertial frames are identical. Inertial, I mean, if you look at very standard definition of inertial frames, people always say that these are the frames in which Newton's law of motion is valid when force is only the real force. All right, but now we have come to a situation that we have one expression, which is this fantastic expression c is equal to 1 upon root epsilon naught mu naught. Remember, this is the expression which really led to the success of Maxwell's equation, because this could predict the velocity of light, which turned out to be equal to the experimental values that we had measured. But really showed marvelously that the lights are electromagnetic waves. All right. Now, it so appears that this particular expression is valid only in one type of inertial frames. Okay, it's one of the possibilities. Okay. And in other frames it's not valid. This implies all the inertial frames, though equivalent from the mechanical point of view, are not equivalent from the point of view of electromagnetic theory. Whenever we are talking of charges and magnetic field, then you land up into problem. Probably all inertial frames are not equivalent. There are certain special inertial frames, okay, in which this particular expression will be valid, and there are certain other frames in which it will not be valid. Okay, a special frame may then exist. Okay, if you want, we can call this as an absolute rest, and that's what people thought, that something like absolute rest. Okay, so only in that particular inertial frame, this particular expression which I have given, C is equal to 1 upon under root epsilon naught mu naught, is valid. In other frames, it's not valid. So, though they are all inertial frames, okay, I'm not talking of non-inertial frames at all, they're all inertial frames, but out of those inertial frames, there are certain specific frames, okay, only with which this particular expression is valid. Now, what is your pick? Imagine yourself in the late 19th century when these things were being discussed, okay, you have two possibilities, okay. That you allow fundamental constants to become frame dependent, that's one possibility. Second is that you allow only a special frame of reference, that you say that this fundamental constants are not frame dependent, but on the other hand, the expression is a frame dependent quantity. It means the C is equal to 1 upon under root epsilon naught mu naught is valid only in a special frame. I mean, ideally, if you can imagine yourself at that time, probably you are not happy with any of the situation. Ideally, you would not like any of these situations to happen. But if there is no other choice given to you, probably you will prefer what we call as a lesser evil. Okay? Out of these two possibilities, the possibility which appears to be more favorable, that you assume that there is a special inertial frame of reference. To treat epsilon naught, mu naught, which we have always thought of as fundamental constants, to be frame dependent is bigger evil than treating that there is a special inertial frame of reference in which this particular expressions are valid. This is what I have written. Do you allow fundamental constants to become frame dependent, or you allow a special inertial frame? Ideally none, but if there is no other choice given, one is likely to prefer lesser evil, which is the second choice. And that's what people in the classical physicist area in the 19th century preferred, that there is one special inertial frame of reference. Only in that particular frame of reference, this expression is valid. In no other frame of reference, it was valid. And this particular frame of reference was called ether. So, earlier ideas favored the concept of a special frame of reference. And this was also supported by some of the other things about which were sort of what we call as uncomfort zone. See, all the waves that we knew required a medium to travel. So-called sound waves, always requires a medium to travel. Okay, like ocean waves, they require a medium to travel. On the other hand, light comes from distant stars, they reach Earth, where there doesn't seem to be any medium. So people thought probably there is some medium, but which we are not able to see. Okay, there has to be some medium. Okay, when we are talking of a wave to travel, it requires a medium. So that let there be a medium. Okay, and this medium, could be the same medium that we are talking ether. So it was. Let me just read. Earlier ideas favored the concept of a special frame. Light also does not seem to require a medium to travel, unlike other waves like sound waves. So it was imagined that the universe is filled with ocean of ether. Light needs this medium to travel. So you assume, this was a very, very simple way of thinking. It's a very natural way of thinking, a classical way of thinking, okay, which, as I said, even first year students who come here, that's the way they always think, that let's assume that the entire universe is filled with something, okay, it's like ocean, okay. Ocean, different fishes, different type of sea animals move. Okay, so it's exactly the same thing. You have the entire universe is filled with a medium called ether. Okay, and in this ether medium, all the planets, galaxies, etc., are all within this particular medium. This particular ether we can consider as an absolute rest. And let's assume that this expression C is equal to 1 upon under root epsilon naught mu naught is valid only in this particular ether medium. It's not present in any other medium. Okay. And let's assume that this particular medium signifies absolute rest. Its implications, all planets, stars, galaxies float in ether. The speed of light is c, given by the following expression, only in this ether medium. In no other medium, this particular expression is correct. Okay, if you calculate the velocity c and find it to be equal to 1 upon root epsilon naught mu naught, that will be valid only in this ether frame. In any other frame, the velocity of light will be turning out to be different, and in that particular case, this particular expression will not be valid. In other frames, the speed of light would be different from c. One can determine the speed of frame by measuring the speed of light in that frame and comparing with one in ether frame. Alright, so you can always find, see, you calculate the velocity of light in your frame of reference, calculate what is its value, compare with c is equal to what you get from c is equal to 1 upon under root epsilon or mu naught, okay, whatever is, then you can always calculate by standard relative velocity formula what will be the velocity of your frame of reference. It has a larger implication, okay, probably one can see there is a slight amount of uncomfort in these arguments, okay, but nevertheless that is the way people are arguing because they have no other choice. Ether can be thought as signifying absolute rest. Hence, we can ask a question, this is very, very important, we can ask a question, what is the absolute speed of sun or what is the absolute speed of earth without specifying the frame. Okay, then what I have said in the classical mechanics, Newtonian mechanics, if you want to talk of velocity, okay, you have to specify frame. If I say, okay, in earth's frame, okay, this particular table which is in front of me is at rest, but in sun's frame, it is not at rest. Okay, so when I am, or in train's frame of reference, this is not at rest. If I am moving, the table is not rest, table is moving backwards. Okay, so if I am calculating the speed of any object, if I am saying the speed, the train is moving with the speed of, let us say, 100 kilometers per hour, okay, this is with respect to earth. Okay, though I may not always say this thing, but this is sort of implied. See, when I say that particular train, you know, the, for example, super fast trains can move with a speed of 350 kilometers per hour, this is with respect to earth. Okay, though we may not say, okay, but it is sort of understood. Okay, with respect to sun, the speed of the same train will be different. Okay, if there was another train moving on a train, track parallel to it, with respect to that train, the speed will be different. So, in Newtonian mechanics, we said that you cannot talk of speed unless you specify the frame. But here I am landing into a different situation. It says, okay, you can always say, what is the speed of the earth without specifying with respect to what? Okay, the idea would be that, okay, the speed has to be mentioned with respect to ether, because ether is supposed to be absolute rest. It is supposed to be filling everywhere. Okay, so if I say what is the speed of the sun, okay, the sun speed has to be measured with respect to ether. Ether becomes your absolute rest. You can give a unique value of velocity or speed to any object, okay, with reference to ether. It is a very, very important, far-reaching conclusion. Broader implication, though all the frames are equivalent from the point of view of mechanical point of view, they need not be from the electromagnetic point of view. See, pure mechanics does not lead to this particular fact. See, so long we are not talking about electromagnetic theory, so long we are not talking about electric forces, magnetic forces, we are not introducing the concept of light as electromagnetic wave, we had no problem. We thought that all inertial frames are equivalent. Okay, but as soon as I introduce electromagnetic theory, I start having problem. Okay, it means, is it so that inertial frames are equivalent only from mechanical point of view, so long there is no electromagnetic theory involved, so long there is no electromagnetic force involved? Okay, but when we talk of electromagnetic theory, there, okay, there is one inertial special frame of reference, ether, which exists. But strictly speaking, there is no real process which is purely mechanical. Okay, there are always, I mean, if you never talk of friction forces, they are actually because of the sort of electromagnetic forces between them. At least, if you want to observe something, the light has to go there and it has to come back and reflect it to it. I mean, there is no mechanical, a 100% mechanical force. Is it a chance that nature has made mechanical processes equivalent in inertial frames, but not the electromagnetic processes? Okay, are we really happy with the situation? Okay, I am pretty sure that all of us will realize that we are not happy with the situation. So, let us just look and test whether we can look at the experiments. I mean, we always fall back upon experiments to tell whatever we are saying is correct or not. So, let us fall back on experiments, okay, and let us see really that this particular statement of the presence of ether is correct or not. So, I think I will stop here. I will talk about the famous Michelson-Morley experiment, one of the most interesting experiments which tried to look for the ether and was unsuccessful. Okay, we'll take a few questions today.
Don Bosco.
Don Bosco, Guwahati, you have some questions?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So my question is the inertial frame an ideal concept? Can we really find inertial frames in nature? Because as far as I know, the Earth is not exactly an inertial frame.
Definitely not. The fact is that, I mean, there is no, I mean, perfections doesn't exist in nature. Let's go to this particular thing. I'm probably talking of philosophy. There is nothing which is perfect. Okay, so I don't think a perfectly inertial frame of reference exists. But let me put it like that, that for any given problem, a frame of reference which is as close to inertial frame of reference as possible can always be imagined. For example, when I am trying to describe the motion of, let's say, a car or a train or a plane, okay, Earth is a reasonably good amount, reasonably good type of inertial frame of reference. Of course, I have to realize that then I have to introduce something which are called fictitious forces to understand every part of physics, because we realize that Earth is not strictly speaking inertial frame of reference. But it depends, what happens when we go from, in mechanics, when we go from inertial to non-inertial frame of reference? We have to give rise to some other forces which are not real forces, which we call as fictitious forces or pseudo forces. Okay? If these forces are small enough so as not to disturb the motion of the object that I am interested in, okay, I can treat this particular frame of reference as inertial frame of reference. Now, forces like centrifugal forces, Coriolis forces, though they are real forces which will be present on Earth, because Earth is not really an inertial frame of reference, so long these forces are comparatively much smaller than the force that I apply to a train to make it accelerate, okay, I can ignore the fact that Earth is a non-inertial frame of reference. So I can always find an approximately inertial frame of reference for a given situation.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome. K.K. Wagh, College of Engineering, Nashik.
Hello, sir.
Yes. Yes.
Hello.
Yeah. Please, I can hear you. Yes.
Sir, there are many microscopic events where we apply Newton's laws of motion.
Yes, right.
Can we apply the concept of inertial frame of reference or non-inertial frame of reference in that case?
See, thing is that, as I told you that, you know, see, when you're talking of really microscopic, you know, see, let me be very clear. See, there is a limit of application of classical mechanics. See, classical, I'm putting in somewhat subjective manner, so I mean, please excuse me for that. As a scientific person, one should not do it, but just to give you a feeling, see, the traditional classical mechanics is valid when we are talking of bigger particles. If you are talking of, let's say, particles like electrons or neutrons or something like that, we have to go to quantum mechanics, which is a totally different mechanics. Okay. Similarly, the classical mechanics is valid only when our speeds of the objects that we are observing is much smaller than the speed of light. Okay. If the object speed turns out to be closer to speed of light, the relativistic effects will start coming in. So classical mechanics has its own limitations. Okay. Of course, you can also thought of quantum particles which are moving very large speed in comparison to speed of light, okay, of that order of speed of light. In that case, we use what we call as a relativistic quantum mechanics, which is much more advanced topic. Okay. So long you are within the limitation of classical mechanics, you can always apply Newton's law of motion. The only penalty you have to pay if you are not in a proper inertial frame of reference, but in a non-inertial frame of reference, that you have to give rise to certain forces which are, we call as fictitious or pseudo forces. The difference between real forces and a fictitious force is that in real force, they are always resulted by interaction between a pair of particles. While pseudo forces, for example, centrifugal force, Coriolis force, okay, they are not an outcome of an interaction between two bodies. They are present just because you are in a non-inertial frame of reference. Now, in a given non-inertial frame of reference, if these influence of pseudo forces are much smaller in comparison to the forces which are real forces, then you can ignore the fact that you are in an inertial frame of non-inertial frame of reference and talk only about the treat this as an inertial frame of reference. That's what we do when we are sitting on Earth. As I said, if I want to describe the motion of a car, okay, I always treat Earth to be an inertial frame of reference, which I know it's not. Because in principle, this car will also be subjected to what we call as a Coriolis force, will also be sort of experiencing a centrifugal force, okay, and it so happens that the amount of this pseudo force, okay, is so small in comparison to the force that you will apply in order a car to accelerate, okay, is negligible. So I treat this Earth as a inertial frame of reference. So depending upon the problem, okay, you may have to consider. But on the other hand, if you are sitting on a merry-go-round and want to walk along the merry-go-round, okay, then you have to apply centrifugal force, you have to apply Coriolis force, which are pseudo forces.
Thank you, sir.
K.S. Rangaswamy College.
Good afternoon, sir. Hello, good afternoon, sir. I have two questions.
Yeah, please go ahead.
It's from crystallography.
Yeah.
Can we have Miller indices beyond using the three HKL indices? In some solid state books, I have seen the crystal planes of hexagonal lattices are shown like one bar 0, 0.
Yeah, that's right. You are
and,
right.
How will you say it is a four dimensional axis?
Okay. That's again a very interesting question. See what happens, strictly speaking, in hexagonal crystals also, you can use only three Miller indices. Okay. Fourth index is superfluous. In fact, you can find the fourth index, okay, if you know the first three index. The thing is that you take, I mean, as I said in hexagonal thing, okay, you take this as A and this as B and C as this. Now, there is also possibility, if I do not remember, I think you take one and you take another, or you take this and this. So, you take one more axis and take intercepts of one particular plane in three axes along this xy plane and fourth along this this direction. And then in principle, you introduce a fourth Miller index also, okay, which as I say is superfluous because it's not really necessary. But why we introduce is because when we are talking of equivalent planes in hexagonal crystals, you may find that this plane is equivalent to this particular plane, is also equivalent to this particular plane. So, in order to, and hexagonal is a very, very important type of crystal structure. So, in order to introduce those equivalent planes, sometimes people prefer to write the fourth index also. So, it is only done in the case of hexagonal as far as I know, okay, and this is not really necessary, it is just for the sake of convenience. You have another question?
Another one more is?
Yeah.
Why we use reciprocal space, whether our samples and elements are evaluated in the direct lattice space only? Then why we use reciprocal space to illustrate the structure?
See,
what
the
is the significance using reciprocal space?
I mean, reciprocal lattice space, in fact, I had tried to answer this question in the morning when I said that, you know, we do it because it makes certain lives, certain things easier. If you want to visualize a particular Bragg reflection, people use, for example, the concept of Brillouin zone, the people use the concept of what is called Ewald spheres, about which I have not talked about it. They are all drawn in the reciprocal lattice space. To visualize what type of reflections that you are going to get, okay, well, these days we have computer programs, you know, 50 years back we did not have computer programs, almost everything has to be done manually. You found people in the reciprocal lattice space to observe and to see which reflections you will get or which diffraction peaks you will be getting, much simpler. So, it is only from the point of view of convenience that we introduce the concept of reciprocal lattice space. And as I said, if you are looking at the conservation of what we call as crystal momentum, which is one of the fundamental equations, conservation equations in crystals, okay, you have to use a concept of reciprocal lattice. It is basically for making our life easier. Techno India, Salt Lake, Calcutta.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon. Yes,
my
please.
Question is actually not related with the topic you have covered in this session, but I want to ask you that how we can explain the motion of photon, why we can explain the motion of proton through the help of relativity only? Why could we explain it with the help of Newtonian mechanics? Is there any way to explain it that if we apply Newtonian mechanics to the photon particle, then it will fail? And if we apply relativity to the photon particle, it can only explain the motion of photon.
See, as I told you that, you know, Newtonian mechanics doesn't work. It's no longer valid when you are talking with speeds closer to the speed of light. And photon is a particle which travels with actually speed of light. So, obviously, your standard classical mechanics will not work there. In fact, in classical mechanics, I mean, you cannot, you know, you don't even have a concept that a particle can have zero rest mass. Because, I mean, there is nothing like a velocity dependent mass. So, obviously, those ideas will not be valid in Newtonian mechanics. So, I can never imagine to apply Newton's law of motion to a concept of a photon. Okay? Because, see, as we will be seeing when we are coming, we are going little deeper into special theory of relativity, we will feel that you will see strong departures. Of course, I will be only be able to talk about Lorentz transformation, I will not be able to talk about, let us say, force transformation, but you will realize that we get strong departures from Newton's law of motion as the speed of the particle approaches the speed of light.
Can we apply some law of classical mechanics to photon and show that it fails?
As I say, rest mass is zero, so if you apply any force on this particular thing, it should not move. But we know, for example, the photons does get affected by gravity. For example, you know, you have a concept of things like black holes, etc. So, when it's very, very clear that, you know, on the basis of purely classical mechanics, you cannot imagine to apply that thing.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, we are stopping. If you have any questions, please, you know, post these questions. So, we'll try to answer most of them. Yes.